Get to some New York political headlines now. Big Apple Mayor Bill de Blasio and his wife Shirlane McRae were on The View Monday. De Blasio defended his Tale of Two Cities campaign theme, and then Barbara Walters asked him and asked the mayor about people who think the mayor is against the rich.
No, not at all. The notion is, first of all, I thought those who are doing well could pay a little more so we could achieve full-day pre-K. I thought that was a worthy investment in our kids, and those who are doing well could help us do it. But it's not an either-or. It's simply saying a society where so many people are hurting economically, we're not on the right track. We have to find
but
a way to bring up
raise
working
taxes
people. Well, we got the money from Albany for the pre-K and the after-school program, so we got it done another way.
All right, so he seems to be walking back a little bit of the rhetoric from the campaign. He was decidedly more Tale of Two Cities during the campaign itself. Is this a PR move? Obviously it is for the de Blasios, and can it work to sort of improve
his image? Barely discernible, by the way, barely.
As a PR move?
No, barely discernible that he's walking back his rhetoric. It was a little bit better there, but not by much. Clearly, it's a PR move, but I think they're missing the point here. The problem has never been his likability, and he does have a very interesting sort of personal story that people find compelling.
And they got a lot
the
of
problem,
that on The View yesterday.
New Yorkers are a tough bunch, and they want to know, they don't really care at the end of the day. They want you to pick up the garbage. They want you to pick up the snow. They want you to help rebuild after Sandy. They want to make sure that they have jobs to go to. It is a more practical executive position, and he has yet to do anything to really demonstrate that he's up for that task. So I would be, if I was advising him, I would be focusing more on measurable, practical goals rather than focusing on lofty sort of personal things or personal rhetoric or the continuing the campaign, which he's done.
Great advice. The mayor needs to pick issues that he can win. You know, something that's not too far, that don't get too far ahead of him. You can't change the world overnight. You surely can't change New York's political landscape overnight. You know, when I watch him on shows like The View, of course that's PR, but it's something that the mayor of New York has to do, and he's adjusting in that role. I mean, he's doing okay, and I'm sure that the mayor, somewhere in the back of his mind, you know, with appearances like that, because he's not filthy rich like our last mayor, is the fact that Governor Cuomo just got $180,000 part of his advance for a book. And I'm sure Mayor de Blasio is thinking about things like that and his legacy and so on. So that softens his image a little bit.
Has he really not demonstrated the sort of practical day-to-day governance that you were talking about before? I mean, the roads still move, the snow got plowed. I mean, it didn't...
There were several issues with the snow getting plowed, with schools being closed last minute. He, you know, one of the biggest
issues... The city's
still
functioning.
Yeah, it was functioning, but at a lower level. You just saw this weekend a horrible tragedy with two young kids that were killed because the ambulances didn't get them in time at a fire. They were killed. There's massive problems. Like, you need to just create an appearance and do that through very specific goals that the city is functioning. And there were multiple things that happened that played into the fact that he has never held an executive management position before.
There have certainly been incidents, but there have always been incidents. There were snowstorms under Bloomberg where he got criticized. There have been delayed 911 responses under Bloomberg. I know it's on the mayor, but is it fair to Jessica's point that this represents some sort of lack of leadership or lack of management
on de Blasio? No doubt about it. It did indicate a lack of leadership. I believe Mr. de Blasio came into the job believing that he was still the public advocate. It's hard to adjust to the fact, and I've said this repeatedly and I will continue to say it, every time the mayor of New York goes somewhere, there's about 30 reporters not just dissecting his words. How did he say it? What did he really mean? Mm-hmm. What was the implication? Who was he really talking to? And that's almost like an acquired taste. I will give him a little credit. He's doing something a little different. I don't understand this yet. I know bypassing the filter of the media, but I believe once a month, this guy goes on a rap radio station. It's once a month, I believe he does it. It's Hot 97 in New York City. And he's talking to disc jockeys that obviously, no disrespect to them, but they don't know the first political issue. So he can easily manipulate them. But, you know, to turn on a rap station and the mayor of New York is on the station once a month.
He's had a very rocky relationship with the press. There was the issue of him calling to get his political pal released from prison. I mean, there have been a series of missteps that have really hurt him in his first 100 days layout. You know, convincing New Yorkers that he's up to the job.
And this may be one of them. On Monday, before he hit The View, Mayor de Blasio made an appearance on the Fox Business Network, where host Maria Bartiromo, I've never been able to say her name, grilled him about his definition of income inequality.
We say income inequality because it's a touchstone for a bigger set of challenges. You know, at this moment, the fact is that the most intense income disparity we've had in this city since the Great Depression. So it's a touchstone to say, look, something's happening here. It's not to begrudge people who have done well. People who have done well contribute a lot to the city. They pay a lot of taxes. A lot of them are very charitable. It's looking at the fact that skew talks also, and most importantly, about the fact that many, many people are falling behind. It really threatens the cohesion of our society. It threatens the future of our society. It certainly threatens some of what makes New York City so great.
Now, that is not new for Mayor de Blasio, but he also spoke about job creation in the city. He said he doesn't believe businesses will flee the city to seek economic relief in states like Florida or Texas, and that they haven't been fleeing the city at this point. And my reaction, he's been a mayor for 4 months. It seems a little early to be saying, no, look, see, all the businesses are staying put.
That's a scary statement. I mean, that shows a huge naivete about how the economy works, how the private sector works. New York is losing businesses and population faster than any other state. And by the way, they don't need to go that far to get out of New York City. The taxes and regulations are directly impact job growth. They can go across the river to New Jersey. They can go up to Connecticut. They can go up to Westchester. There's a lot of places they can go to be in a more friendly business climate, including out of New York State altogether, which he doesn't understand and fails to grasp that it ends up having a worse impact down the road for the very people that he's trying to help.
But the thought that came to mind, Dominic, was that it's too early to know if businesses are fleeing because of de Blasio policies. I mean, 4 months, it doesn't seem like there's enough data in. It's also too early to say if businesses are growing and expanding because of de Blasio policies.
But remember, he's appearing on the Fox Business Show.
Yeah.
And when you look at his far-left politics, it doesn't exactly blend with the business community. And so the natural assumption is that under his watch, businesses may leave. And so the mayor's working on his answers, and, you know, he's fine-tuning his approach, and maybe he'll get there. You know, it's hard because when you're the public advocate, let's face it, nobody listens to what you're saying. You're just, you're complaining. No, seriously. When you're the public advocate, you complain for a living. That's
yeah.
what you do.
Yeah.
Let's not forget they tried to eliminate the job several times. That's how much, you know, work the public advocate really does. So this guy who was in dead last in the mayor's race, his son appears with an afro. Let's call it for what it is. The son takes off with the electorate, even though only 25% of the total electorate turned out. His son gets him elected. He goes from worse to first of the Democratic primary, and now he's the mayor of the greatest city on earth. It's a tall challenge.
All right, let's move on to the race in Harlem and the South Bronx for Congress. Longtime Harlem Congressman Charlie Rangel, he's preparing to face off against a new contender entering the ring for his congressional seat. Yolanda Garcia is the new candidate. Maybe, it hasn't formally filed yet, but she would join Adriano Espaillat and Reverend Michael Waldron in the bid to unseat the 22-term congressman. Garcia has not yet filed her official paperwork to enter the race, and Espaillat's camp has accused her of trying to siphon votes. What's your take? Is she a siphon votes candidate? Is she a Latino alternative to Espaillat?
Congressman Rangel doesn't pass the smell test. But you gotta, you know, of course, the Rangel camp will say, we have absolutely nothing to do with this. This is an independent candidate who's running on her own. And if she happens to split the Latino vote, so be it. I'm reelected. And so, I mean, I don't know why she's planning on running. I have a funny feeling she's definitely going to run. Whoever got her to run, it's a great tactic to get Congressman Rangel reelected.
And it's the kind of tactic that happens a lot. And I'm just curious, as a campaign strategist, let's say hypothetically there was, I don't know, a governor's race where a liberal candidate entering into the race would be beneficial to, let's say, a Republican candidate. Is there any coordination there? Are there subtle ways of making something happen to make sure that that opponent gets into the race that helps the guy
Look, I mean, this kind of stuff happens all the time, and certainly Charlie Rangel didn't survive all these years in office without being, you know, politically smart. And I say break out the popcorn for this one because it's getting really nasty pretty early. But, you know, this, it happens, and especially in New York, it happens because you have third-party ballot lines, which not every state has. So there's all kinds of weird stuff that can happen. You can have a Democrat with a conservative line.
Is there?
No, I don't think it's typical that you coordinate directly with the campaigns, but sometimes there's, you know, an emissary person that has contacts in both campaigns, a money person. You know, I don't know if he's directly coordinating or not, but it's certainly, he's the one that's benefiting from this turmoil between
Andrew,
the two of them.
This is one of these, when you ask if there's coordination, this is one of these wink-wink type situations. We have absolutely nothing to do with it. That's the official response from any campaign, Democrat or Republican. And then maybe 5 years from now, we'll find out that there was some coordination.
Wink-wink.
Wink-wink.
Well, one of those.
Right.
All right, now speaking of dirty politics, I love this topic. Up next, justices of the nation's highest court weigh in on whether a state can make it illegal for politicians to lie about each other or to lie in a campaign. Practice is nothing new to politics. It's as old as politics itself. Should it be illegal? We're going to be right back with that.